Good morning, everyone. This is Brooke Rouse from the St. Lawrence County Chamber of Commerce. Thank you so much for joining us for our morning buzz. We are excited to be offering some kind of quick focus sessions this month, each Tuesday at 9 a.m. So for those who are joining us for the first time, welcome. And for those of you who were with us last week, welcome back. Certainly hope you'll join us for the weeks to come. So today we're focusing on a very timely and important topic, and we really hope that this session can be interactive as well. So I'll kind of go through some of this information, and then I open it up to questions and conversation. This is being recorded mostly the first part. I won't necessarily publish the question and answer, so don't feel like you need to be shy in the question and answer. But we'll get into it, and I'm happy again to share the recording after. It's a lot of information that I tried to condense for today, and also to just kind of hit the high points, and then we can get into some conversation as well. So we know as we're going into the summer, hopefully people are looking at the opportunities to host events under the state reopening plans that have really started to reopen more recently with access to the vaccine and kind of the trends that we're seeing, certainly in the North Country, positive negative trends where things are looking good for the summer. So so I always try to phrase things as opportunities, but certainly we have to work within some limitations. And we, at the Chamber anyway, as we're helping people navigate different event opportunities, and the same for us as hosts of some upcoming events, we are trying to plan now with what we know now, and with keeping in mind that if things open up more by the time of our event, for example, we have one in September, if things open up at that point, then we're going to be flexible to roll with that. But it's very difficult to wait for the guidelines. So I think it's best practice just to plan for what exists today, even if your event is in 2 or 3 months. So I just wanted to present kind of an overview of the timeline of how event-related guidelines have opened up very recently in the last month. And this was also in the email reminder I sent for today. So hopefully that is helpful. So you can see, you know, over time, things have increased quite rapidly in March. And I'll skip down to the bottom dates there. So the most important thing to know now is that gathering limits, general public gathering limits, increased to 100 people for indoors and 200 people for outdoors. And that's for without testing, but certainly with masks and social distancing. So that goes for any general outdoor gathering. You know, in the beginning, we saw limits of 10 people. This is that same guideline. So that really applies to pretty much any gathering that might not fit into any of these other guidelines. That's a really important kind of rule of thumb to be planning with at this point. So there's also noted here that with testing and other advanced health protocols, the lesser of 75% occupancy or 150 people for indoor events. So proof of testing, the state now has an app that is called the Excelsior Pass that people can show if they had their test within the time frame, or can show that they've received the vaccine. So that is kind of an addition to that. And the other guideline that we really have eyes on now is that event, entertainment, and art venues, whether that's indoor and outdoor, were able to reopen as of April 2nd with lesser of 33% occupancy or 100 people indoors or 200 people outdoors. So if you have a large venue, field, outdoor park type thing. It is based on either 200 people, you know, if you could fit 1,000 people in there, that's fine. But this is 200 people or the lesser of the 33%. So if 33% of that land mass equals 600 people, that does not qualify. It's the lesser amount. So really you're working with 200 people at an outdoor venue. If you require testing and or other advanced health protocols, which translates to vaccine, then proof of that will increase your limits to 150 people indoors or 500 people outdoors. Again, as an event organizer or as a venue, this can be a bit overwhelming, as you can imagine, to check that testing. Again, the state has created an app called the Excelsior Pass that would allow people to update their health information and show that pass at an event. If there are any questions along the way, please chime in. So I might pause right now, actually, to see if there are any questions. You can unmute yourself, or you can certainly type in the chat box as well, if you prefer.
Brooke, I have a question.
Yeah.
When it says people, how does that relate to children under 12 or under 16?
That's a good question. I have not seen it identified as excluding those people. I think that's still, I'm not sure. That has not been identified specifically in these guidelines that I've seen. So I'll make note of that, and I'll ask our reps at the state and at the county level. Very good question.
Thank you.
I think in general, when you're looking at just social distancing, that they should be included, but you're right, if they're not being tested or can get the vaccine, certainly that plays into checking them and increasing those numbers. So, and I will also note, as we'll get into, some of the guidelines include in this number staff and participants, and others exclude those. So that's another kind of detail as you move through. So again, I just picked out a couple of the different guidelines that I think are most relevant to what we're hearing in terms of what people are trying to do for the summer. So I'll cover these a little bit in the email. Again, I included some links directly to the state guidelines. You can also access them at forward.ny.gov and search around there within the phases to find the proper guidelines. So these are some of the newer guidelines that we're anxiously awaiting and wanted to cover. So this is interim guidance for small and medium scale performing arts and entertainment. So this is really focused on in-person performance and live entertainment. And it kind of details what that might look like. We are finding that most of the events we're looking at and thinking about will most likely fit under this guideline. So it also notes that it applies to all ticketed and non-ticketed, seated and standing at performance and live entertainment events held in public or private venues. So again, that's likely going to hit the mark for a lot of things that we're looking at the county. So, and it's with an indoor capacity of less than 1,500 attendees or an outdoor capacity of less than 2,500 attendees. So effective the beginning of this month, these venues are allowed to have up to 200 attendees outdoors, 100 attendees indoors, and this is before testing. Again, if you require testing or proof of vaccine, then you go up to 150 attendees indoors and 500 attendees outdoors. So very similar to the general gathering size. And for this one, it's exclusive of employees, talent performers, contractors, and vendors. So that's a really important and helpful detail. You know, a lot of these events will have production staff, performers, volunteers. All of those people would be excluded from the 200 attendee count. So that's also important to be mindful of. Continuing with these guidelines, it does require you, if you fit within these guidelines, to notify the county public health department. And I will have the email address for you, hopefully by the end of the call. I've been in touch with the county public health this morning, specifically on the best email for that. If you go onto the St. Lawrence County Public Health, there is a contact form. And so that's where you can start just to say that we're having this event. So at least 5 days ahead of time, you would need to submit this kind of safety plan with details of your event to the county health authority. There is not a approval process at this time at the county level. The process now is that it would be submitted, I think, sooner rather than later, but at least 5 days ahead of the event. And if there's any feedback from County Public Health, they would provide that, but it's not an approval process of a committee or anything like that. So again, just general information about the event so that they are aware what is happening and can just really just be mindful and help provide any guidance as needed. Are there any questions on this guidance before we go on to some of the others? And each event needs to have a safety plan that would include this information, but also what you're doing in terms of distancing, hygiene. There are a couple other scrolling. Yeah. Any other on-site activities, if there's catering or food, protective equipment, communication, which is more specific to tracing, how you're going to communicate with attendees and employees, as well as any tracing that might be required or recommended. And that's a really important piece too, is that for all of this guidance, it's pretty clear on the state site what is required and what is recommended. So I always encourage people to look through that. Certainly make sure you're hitting the required and then have a look at the recommended, because there are some good ideas that may help in your specific venue or scenario to increase a safe and successful event. So certainly have a look there. Any other questions on small, medium scale performing arts and entertainment? So this is kind of similar for low risk outdoor arts and entertainment. So this is defined more as zoos, botanical gardens, nature parks, grounds of historic sites and cultural institutions, outdoor museums, outdoor agritourism, agricultural demonstrations, and other related institutions or activities. So it's kind of looking more at the entertainment side of it, or kind of the more physical permanent presence of something that is outdoor. And it also makes note here that if you're having any sort of activity like this and you start to include other things like food trucks or catering or retail or vendors or athletic elements of the event, then those would each have their own safety plan per the guidance that's provided for them. So that's just, you know, a lot of our events, community events that typically happen in the summer include a number of different activities. And so you just need to make sure that the guidelines are being followed for each of those elements. So in this, it notes that you have to limit the workforce and patron visitor presence to no more than 33% of the maximum occupancy for a particular area at any given time. And this is inclusive of patrons and visitors who must only be permitted entry into the institution if they wear an acceptable face covering, provided they are over the age of 2. Any questions on this one? All right.
Brooke, that last one would, things like I'm just, oh, it's not really apple season yet, but you know, any kinds of things like apple orchards and those kinds of outdoor settings that individuals are allowed to come to, would that fit under that or one of the other guidances?
I think there's specific guidance for that type of thing. It does mention here outdoor agritourism, agricultural demonstrations. So potentially it would be here, but I believe there was also specific guidance on this late in the summer last year.
Okay.
But if anyone's interested in that, we can pull that directly as well. So the other set of guidelines that we look at closely is the guidance for farmers markets. So as many of you probably saw last year, most of the farmers markets around the county carried on, and they were deemed essential early on as access to food and support for farmers and food production. And so this guidance goes under ag and markets. And so you do have to, for any farmer's market, COVID or not, you do have to submit just a form to Ag and Markets listing vendors, and you do have to have at least 2 food producers at your farmer's market. And so that's pre-COVID requirements with Ag and Markets. And then for the COVID guidelines, which were last updated last August, and I have confirmation that these are the most recent, but potentially there will be others coming out. But at this point, it's pretty general guidance following general safety precautions that we've all been looking at, spacing out vendors, minimizing the food customers are directly accessing. So having vendors physically hand them things versus them, you know, taking out of a bin or something like that. Increased hand washing stations and hand sanitizer, managing customer traffic, directionals, things like that. They have to follow the food safety at farmers markets guidelines that are typically in place. And then, the organizer needs to be in communication with Ag and Markets and have their plan approved. The other thing with the farmers market is that all vendors must have their own safety plans, and the market itself must have a safety plan. So those are just on site, they're not submitted. Again, any entertainment or other things that are happening at the market would fall under the guidelines of that particular activity. So some of the events we're seeing, for example, we held our craft food and wine show at the Power and Equipment Museum last September. That fits under a farmer's market when we do those events annually indoors, typically at SUNY Potsdam or Clarkson. It is normally under a farmer's market permit in order to be able to serve food and wine tastings at those events. And so this is where we fit for that. So there's a potential that different events throughout the county can fit within this type of guideline. Any questions on the farmers market? So again, as I mentioned before, on each of the guidelines, the state provides mandatory versus recommended practices. And one of them that comes up a lot in conversation with folks we're working with is the need to screen and or the need to require proof of testing or proof of vaccine. So as I mentioned before, the proof of vaccine or test is only required to hit that next level of occupancy. If you keep under the 200 outdoors, 100 indoors, then the testing and vaccine are not required. It's when you, if you want to increase occupancy, that you would need to have that in place. Screening, which most of us are probably familiar with if you've been in the workplace or attending any special meetings or anything like that, or have kids in school or kids in sports, you've seen the screening. So this is where they ask about symptoms in the last 14 days, positive test, close or proximate contact with a confirmed case. And so that's the general screening that is typically just recommended for patrons and visitors. It's almost always required for staff within business safety plans. And so, you know, if you're putting on an event at your venue or at an outdoor kind of community-based venue, you would have to have all of your volunteers and staff go through the screening on a daily basis. But for the audience, the patrons and visitors, it is not required typically. It is certainly recommended. And so you can make that decision for your event. Some of the ways that you can do screening is if you have pre-ticketed events. So there are some online options to do this in a free or very low cost for your event, which may also help you manage attendees. So you can have the screening kind of built into your pre-ticketing. Perhaps they buy or secure their free ticket, and then you have a follow-up the day before the event because you'll have access to their email, where they're required to complete the screening before they attend the event. So that's something that you can look at. We've also seen some events and in sports that they've used Google Forms to do the screening. So you can create a form with the screening, have the person identify their name, and then as the event organizer, it feeds into a spreadsheet. So when they check in for the event, you can pull up their name and see that they've completed the screening process. So that's another really low cost / no cost option as well. And then you can always do manual on-site screening and temp checks. So this might look a few different ways. If people are walking in, you could ask them the questions. You could show them a sign with the things to say, you know, yes or no. You could require them to fill out a little form or a little ticket saying that they're good to go. You can also do temperature checks if you'd like. Again, these are recommendations, not requirements. You can purchase and have folks on hand who are doing the temp checks. Any questions on this? There's a question about the fact that most of the events in the county are organized by volunteers. Certainly businesses that are trying to get meetings and catering and weddings and things like that back into place, these guidelines apply. But yes, for any volunteers or businesses who need help kind of navigating this, we can certainly help provide recommendations and an overview of the options and help direct them towards the guidelines that they can then go through the checklist for. So certainly have people get in touch with us on that. The other thing to think about there is that if you as the organizer are hosting an event, I think I mentioned, that has multiple components. Each of the components needs to fit within their own guidelines. So if there's sports opportunity, farmers market on site, entertainment on site as well, you need to kind of potentially have separate safety plans and follow those guidelines or incorporate them into a full event safety plan while identifying the specific guidelines. And we have some sample safety plans, and the state also has safety plans on their site. So have a look at that. Any other questions on screening or the vaccine and testing? And again, I'm just presenting what we are reading and continuing to understand from the state site. We're not speaking on behalf of the county or public health. We're just trying to help people understand and get the resources needed and hopefully proceed with hosting events in a safe and successful way. It's a really good way to get things moving again, get the economy moving again, improve, I think personal mental health and things like that. So these are some of the guidelines that I've kind of had bookmarked in terms of events. I also put this in the email to all of you. So hopefully that is helpful. Again, you might look at them and have multiples up at the same time and kind of scratch your head to wonder where you fit, and we can help you navigate that a little bit. There's a lot of gray area. We've been finding just in the last 24 hours, I've had multiple conversations with communities and organizers about where do we fit, and it's really not clear. So at some point you need to pick the guidelines and really just make sure that you're being as safe as possible for everyone involved. We hopefully you've seen some of this stuff. We've created a lot of different images and posters and yard signs and things like that throughout the pandemic to help people get back to life, to restart STLC and reopen things. And so we have a lot of different images like this that you are certainly welcome to use, whether it's in your communication on site, whether it's your communication in promoting your event, whether it's in communication, in your screening process, however you'd like, you can just reach out to us. We also have several of these on our COVID page on our website, which is visitstlc.com/COVID-19. I think you can download them there. But if any of this is helpful, a huge part of this is just making sure that you're communicating far in advance of your event of what is expected. These are the basic pillars of safety that we've been encouraging throughout the process, and they remain true. And again, if our hope is that if you're very clear and upfront that this is to be a safe event and that it's important for everybody, that hopefully people will realize that if they're going to come, they need to follow these directions. And if they are not willing, then they're not welcome, unfortunately. This is another one that we have had up early on in the pandemic last spring and summer, just reminding people that we are certainly all in this together, and the goal is to get things going, keep our economy strong, and work together to hopefully create some new opportunities and proceed with caution, but with creativity as well. So I think that's it for my slideshow. I, again, thought it would be helpful to pull out some of those high points, but I will now open it up for conversation if people are planning things and have questions or thoughts, or if you've seen, in your travels, any creative ways of doing things. Happy to talk about that. And I will also mention, in terms of the farmers market, which could be any kind of vendor festival type event, we hosted kind of a training ahead of our event last September, where we showed pictures of examples of ways that vendors could interact safely with their customers. And so we're happy to offer that out as well. And we're also working with the Arts Council to hopefully host a session similar to this, specific to concert series and some other outdoor arts events. Any questions? Trish, you've unmuted.
I did. You were just talking about being creative and finding a way to work within what our restrictions are. Could you talk about the nature and networking event that you guys have coming up? Because I think this is a great way to kind of, like, we miss networking, we miss being together as business people. I just think it's a cool approach for working within those parameters.
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. And again, if anyone else has creative ideas, or if you're like, I really want to do this again, I just don't know how to make it work. I have lots of creative ideas. So we're hosting, for those who are chamber members and know, in the past, we have always had our Business in the Spotlight events, which is held at a different business every month from March to October. And we typically have 30 to 80 people, sometimes more, for a really great networking event for our members. And we're not comfortable, although we could potentially be inside under the 100 people limit. We were being a bit more cautious and creative, and we're starting a new series called Nature and Networking. So we're going to have outdoor networking events at different trail networks. So our first one is at the end of this month. I don't want to misspeak. Is it the 24th? At Indian Creek Nature Center. So we'll all gather there, split up into small groups, and folks will get to meet each other and have conversation as they're walking through a really easy trail. So that's an example of what you can do in terms of meetings or networking.
It's the 29th, by the way, Brooke.
29th is a week ahead.
29th at 5 p.m.
29th, 5 p.m. If you want to join us, you can register at slcchamber.org.
Hey, Brooke, I've got lots of questions. Okay. Sorry about that, guys. St. Lawrence County does not have a lot of commercial venues for events such as weddings, parties, etc. And so most people book community halls. So first question is, if someone just books a hall, what are the requirements for the organization?
For the like the municipal organization or the hall owner?
Yeah.
I guess I would say.
Sorry to stump you.
Yeah, no, and it's this is why every scenario is interesting to think about. And if you've looked at these guidelines, they're quite extensive.
And confusing.
And sometimes a little confusing. Although I do like that the state has these different charts that really break it down, which is helpful. I think that you can look at that in a couple different ways. You can, as the venue, if you are not running the event, you are simply renting the space, then you maybe in your contract could make note of the state requirements and encourage them to follow those and have a safety plan. But you, as the owner, to my understanding, I'm trying to think of any examples of this, if they are simply renting the venue, then you're kind of hands off with that.
Okay. And then switching around, if the organization is catering the event, providing the food for the event, I'm sure that changes things.
Yep. So if you are providing any services, certainly catering, there are very specific guidelines for food service that you would need to abide by. And that food service is beyond what we're used to with, certain temperatures of food and how it's served and those sorts of things. this would add kind of the seeded element of it. And those restrictions have been changing recently too, you may have seen, but you would fit under the food service for that.
Okay, so that would be, I've seen where it's, you know, catering is different than restaurants, et cetera. So this would fall under catering.
I think so. And I was looking yesterday to try to find the specific catering guidelines, and I was not able to. So again, some of these things are easy to find and some of them aren't, but I know catering has been mentioned in headlines, but I didn't see specific guidelines. Do you have those, Dee? Did you see?
I saw something. I don't have it handy right now. I'm going to have to dig further. I thought I'd wait to see what happened this morning before I dig more.
Yeah, and I will do the same because I thought they were wrapped up in some other guidelines, but everything I looked at just referred to the food service and the additional guidelines for that. And that also applies, it's also a good example, if you are having an event and you're having food trucks or any food concession, you need to be mindful of that those vendors need to have their safety plans and be working within those guidelines. And in some cases, you also may need to create kind of an outdoor food court where you can more easily enforce, you know, people being seated while they're eating in order to take their masks off, et cetera, so that you don't have people kind of walking around a venue, mask off, eating finger foods and things like that. So that's where it gets a little bit tricky with some of the guidelines, and you have to dig a little bit more. And I'll continue to do that and can share that information as I find any clarification.
And then again, in the same light, what are the penalties if an organization doesn't follow the guidelines?
So the way the county has approached it, and we've been on the reopening committee with the county, which is a combination of economic development agencies and county officials and public health throughout the pandemic. And their approach is that we all just really want you to be safe. And so the county their role is really more in providing guidance. That's what we are doing, as well as the IDA and Cornell Cooperative. But they're not interested in policing as long as people are doing their best to cooperate and follow the guidelines for the sake of the greater community, really. That being said, there are some businesses that have licenses to operate. For example, a food license or a liquor license, or you know, if there are any special permits that are granted by the state, if you do not comply with these rules, you risk losing those licenses. And so that's quite serious for anyone who's ever had to apply for a liquor license and the process that involves. You certainly don't want to lose that. If there are other state licenses or permits as well, then you can certainly be risking that. And to me, there are fines attached with some of these things. But I think more importantly, and the greater negative impact is losing those permits or licenses, which allow you to operate long term.
And finally, if I could just make a suggestion, it would be great if the chamber could reach out to any or hopefully all of these agencies and organizations throughout the county, even just to let them know that guidelines exist. Mm-hmm. But I think there's quite a few who are unfamiliar with the whole idea and think, oh, you know, we're just a community organization. It doesn't apply to us.
Yep. Yeah. And we it's been more than a full-time job for us over the last year, where I think we've sent over 100, COVID specific emails throughout the pandemic, outlining guidelines. We've hosted, I think, 30 at least sessions open to the public. And you can only kind of do so much. We've worked with public health and the IDA to get out press releases and things like that. But with everything, you can only reach so many people. So certainly, for those of you on the call, feel free to share the information with others. Obviously, chamber members who are on our email list are getting that information. That's part of the benefit of membership, that you receive our breakdown of this sometimes overwhelming information. But if others would like assistance, we're certainly here to help. We'll be doing some more outreach with municipalities and things like that, because typically any event would potentially come to a municipality for some sort of permitting or support. And so that's another opportunity for them to make sure that things are being done safely for their community. But if you have any other ideas for that, let us know. Any other thoughts, questions, comments, things you're planning that you're trying to understand? And again, we're just speaking on behalf of the chamber and our, you know, day-to-day continued understanding of all these guidelines. We're not representing the state or the county or county public health, but just trying to break down the information and help the best way that we can. Any other questions, opportunities, thoughts, good examples you've seen? The other thing I wanted to note is that most events require insurance. And sometimes if you are renting a venue, as you mentioned, Dee, if people are renting a venue, the venue may require proof of insurance, liability insurance, or a municipality may require that. And so that's something to look into early on and make sure you have secured as well. And I don't know if anyone else has had experience with insurance or wants to speak on any tips there. Tanya, I see that you're on the line too.
Yeah, I can speak to that real quick. Especially events policy is quite affordable and really easy to apply for. We do them all the time. So it's just a real quick application, and it's about $200 for a typical event. So,
Tanya, do you want to introduce yourself for those who don't know who you are?
Sure. So I'm Tanya Price, and I'm the Associate Vice President at Northern Insuring Agency in the Potsdam office. We do commercial insurance, personal insurance, and health and employee benefits. And like I said, the special events policy is a really easy process. So.
Great. Thank you. I know that's been something that some businesses have had some challenges depending on who their insurance agent is or events. So certainly shop around if you need to get a policy. Tanya, have you seen any changes in that with COVID, or are the event policies pretty much the same as they were before, or are there additional costs or stipulations for getting an event policy right now?
I have not seen any changes in the process or in it at all, no.
Okay, that's good to know. Mm-hmm. So again, I always encourage people, you know, you could think of a million reasons why not, but just get the information straight from the source and then make your decision from there. If it's not going to work for you, that's fine. But certainly just ask the question to see if it's possible. So it's good to know, Tanya, that it's an easy process to get that event policy. Any other thoughts, questions? Trish, did you unmute again?
I just wanted to make a kind of a pitch for the calendar that the county chamber manages to keep track of all these events. I'm the chairperson of my class reunion, my high school class reunion. And I know last year's class reunions were canceled. this year's class reunions are maybes, probably nots, and they're all like pushing to next year. And I just, between those types of events and all the other events that people are ready to start having again, we want to try to avoid like overlapping like crazy on the limited beautiful weather weekends we might have. So just wanted to make a plug for people that are considering an event and looking for timing of it to check your calendar. Let's try to spread things out as best we can in the seasons that we have.
Thanks, Tricia. You're always remember what I forget. So yes, on visitstlc.com, there's a tab right at the top that says events. And when you go into that calendar, there's a little plus sign that you can add. Any community business can add events to that calendar, and we really encourage you to do so for a number of reasons. As Trish mentioned, we want to do our best to either complement events that are happening or avoid major events all on the same weekend. So definitely, as soon as you have any details for your event, date, location, the more the merrier, please add it there, and then we can also add information as it becomes available. You can add registration links, you can add everything to that site. So definitely make a point of that. The other benefit of that is as a promotional tool. So chamber websites rank highly on search engines. And so if someone goes to look for, you know, your 5K event or your festival, they may not find it on your website because it takes a lot of work to get search engines to pick up smaller websites, and it may be picked up on our site, most likely would be, if you use your event name and keywords, and then that can then direct to your website. So that's important. We also use it to promote, certainly as we're getting into the summer and more events are coming on. We will be putting out a monthly calendar to our, we have thousands of emails, leads for people who have visited the county or are interested in visiting the county. And so we want to give them kind of a heads up a month before, at least, of what's coming so that they can plan their visit and kind of get out and enjoy more things or new things. We also work very closely with I Love New York to promote the county as part of the state. And so they're often looking for different thematic events and activities going on. And so we feed that to them. And then the other thing is, you know, to Trisha's point about family or college or high school reunions, whatever the case may be, you know, if this year those events aren't happening, so people aren't planning to come back that first week in August for a reunion, they may say, well, what else is happening in the summer? What do we want to come back for? And so they can go to that event and say, oh, that's cool. And in, you know, these two weekends in July, there's all this stuff going on. Let's come back home that week and spend the whole week and get out and enjoy. We also have people who are planning weddings or conferences use our calendar to kind of beef up their programming. Even the colleges will use that for some of their weekends, which will hopefully start again in the fall or next year. But that's another way they might say, you know, if you're looking for off-site opportunities, all of this stuff is, you can check the calendar or extend your stay if you want to catch some of these other events. So certainly add those events. And Ben put a direct link to that calendar in the chat. Thanks, Ben. Any other questions, comments, please feel free to get in touch with us. You can reach me at brooke@slcchamber.org. You can reach Ben, our new executive director, now on screen, at ben@slcchamber.org. And we've got a team here to help as much as we can, and also working very closely with the IDA and a number of partners across the county to help however we can. And we have a direct line to the state and the county as well, so we can typically get questions answered within 24 hours, which is nice as well. Any other final thoughts, comments?
I'll add a couple. I'll just reiterate, Brooke, that, you know, we are constantly tracking the guidance and everything else that's happening relative to the pandemic, vaccine eligibility, vaccine sites, and we put out pretty much, you know, as needed or weekly bulletins on what you need to know. So if you're not a chamber member yet, I suggest you call us at 315-386-4000 or go to slcchamber.org to sign up and become a member. And then you'll get that great guidance too. Brooke, that was the other thing, is I just want to say thanks, Brooke, for translating the guidance. It can be a little confusing when it's being pushed out by the state or whomever. And so thanks for translating and sharing that with us all here today.
Yes, thank you. And thank all of you for joining us this morning, and definitely be in touch if there's anything we can do to help at all. And we hope we'll be entering into a nice spring summer season have some safe and successful events here on the calendar soon. Take care, everyone. I also did put a link to the Excelsior Pass. If you haven't heard about that, you can learn more about that if you are pursuing events that you want to have above the 200 capacity for an outdoor venue, 100 for indoor. All right. Thank you again. Have a great day, everyone.
Thanks, guys.